This is once again Hariwa Prasad Damarla. In our earlier session, we were discussing one of the subsystems of telephone networks, that is subscriber loop systems. So in part one, we were discussing about the limiting factors on subscriber loop systems. So we were discussing what is the maximum distance at which a telephone connection can be provided with reference to the geographical location of the telecom switch or the telephone exchange. So we have seen about the signaling limits. Now we will further continue our discussion with another limiting factor, that is attenuation limits on subscriber loop systems. Attenuation limits arise from the AC response of the loop and refers to the loop loss in decibels. So attenuation, as we are all aware, so it refers to the loss of the signal. So the loss of the signal between the telephone exchange and the user. What is the maximum loss that can be allowed for satisfactory communication by the user with other user through the telephone exchange? So it depends upon the AC response of the loop, that is the a pair of copper wires between the telephone exchange and the user. The criterion here is to ensure that the quality of the reception at the subscriber end is satisfactory. The main criteria is we have to ensure the satisfactory reception as far as the subscriber is concerned. A rating system standardized by the CCITT, which stands for Consultative Committee for International Telegraph and Telecom. Of course, at present it is known as ITU, International Telecom Union, to grade the customer satisfaction and is known as reference equivalent. So the ITU has standardized the grade of customer satisfaction and it is known as reference equivalent. So with reference to the CCITT reference equivalent, we will assess whether the quality of the signal is okay or not, whether it is meeting the reference equivalent or not. That is the criteria. RE of the telephone set or subscriber loop is arrived at by comparing its performance with the standard. So the reference equivalent of the telephone set or the subscriber loop is compared with the standard set by the ITU. So when it is meeting, it is okay. The connection can be provided at the specified location. But however, it depends upon the AC response of the subscriber loop, which refers to a pair of wires between the exchange and the user. Sometimes a need arises to connect subscribers located beyond the maximum distance prescribed. So a situation may arise in the field, in the industry, wherein you have to provide a telephone connection which is beyond the prescribed limits. some special circumstances may arise in view of the cost consideration and the complexity of establishing another exchange. So here we will look into an example given here. What are the special circumstances under which a telephone connection is to be provided by crossing the prescribed limits? For example, it is not economical to install a new exchange for a lone or a few remote subscribers. In such cases, special techniques are used to meet the resistance and attenuation constraints. So let us assume there are one or two subscribers or a very few customers who are located remotely and far away with reference to the telephone exchange. So to serve those few customers, maybe in the order of 3 to 4 or 5 or 10. So we cannot establish another telephone exchange to serve that area because it is a costly proposition. So we have to take the cost into consideration while providing service as far as the industry is concerned. So in such cases, we will address this problem by some special techniques to meet the resistance constraint, referring to signaling limitations, and attenuation constraints, referring to attenuation limits. So what are all these special techniques? We will try to understand. Subscriber loop systems and the special techniques. The DC resistance constraint is met by use of higher diameter wire. That means the DC resistance issue pertaining to signaling limitation can be addressed by using higher dia cable so that the resistance will be less and it can serve more distance. That means you have to use a low gauge wire. The other one is use of equalized telephone sets. So they are a special type of telephone instruments which can serve with less bias currents. We will look into them. So that we can increase the distance of the subscriber with reference to the exchange. And other solution to address the DC resistance aspect is uni-gauge design or use of higher supply voltage. So we can adopt to uni-gauge, uniform gauge of the wire, or we can adopt the higher supply voltage. So normally exchange works on minus 48 volt DC. So perhaps you can increase the DC voltage, say to minus 72 or minus 96, and you can serve the user located remotely and the resistance constraint can be addressed. The attenuation constraint, the second one, is usually overcome by the use of what is known as loading coils. So the attenuation problem can be addressed by using loading coils. Here I have given a small note about loading coils. A loading coil or load coil is basically an inductor that is inserted into an electronic circuit to increase its inductance. You are increasing the inductance of the electronic circuits. So are increasing the inductance of the copper wire by using the loading coils. The loading coils are used to prevent signal distortion in long distance telecom transmission cables. So by use of this inductance or the loading coils, so you can increase the distance of signal transmission in telephone network. So this is how we can adopt the special techniques. It may be noted that 30 to 40% of the cost of the telephone network comes from the cost of the copper in the subscriber line. Hence, the first technique of using higher diameter copper is rarely used. So, using of higher diameter wire is one solution. But here, the practical problem is like this. So, 30 to 40% of your network cost depends upon the cost of the subscriber loop, that is the copper pair. So by using higher diameter, you have to invest more money towards the establishment of the telecom network. So in normal practice we don't use this except in rare circumstances. Then the second solution is about equalized telephone. Equalized telephone sets require about 8 to 12 milliamps of DC bias current as against 22 to 30 milliamps required by normal telephone. So normal telephone requires 22 to 30 milliamps, whereas equalized telephones, they don't require that much bias currents. So 8 to 12 milliamps may be sufficient so that they can serve more distance. But you have to use the specialized telephones, not normal telephones. You cannot use for increasing the distance from the user to telephone exchange. As a result, a larger value of loop resistance is acceptable. By using equalized telephone sets, it is possible to increase the resistance or the distance from the exchange. Then the other concept is uni-gaze concept. What is that? We will try to understand with the help of this drawing also. In uni-gaze concept, both for long and short distances, the same gaze wire is used. So, as the name suggests, in uni-gaze, whether the subscriber is nearer to the telephone exchange or far away from the exchange, you adopt the same gaze. You don't change the gaze. The gaze may be 26 AWG, something like that. Irrespective of the distance of the subscriber with reference to the exchange, same gauge of wire we are using. So in such case, how you can provide telephone connection at far away place with reference to the exchange? So let us look into these aspects. 48 volts DC is used up to 5 kilometer with 26 AWG. As already I told you, AWG stands for American Wire Gauge. Up to 5 kilometers, we use 48 volts DC supply. So this is the phone. So it is within 5 kilometers. So with this 5 kilometer zone, we can serve generally up to 80% of the subscribers. This is the percentage they have given. S is equal to 80%. So the number of subscribers we can provide connections within this 5 kilometer is generally 80%. Beyond 5 kilometer and up to 8 kilometer, so we go for increasing the exchange voltage from 48 to say 72 or 96 volts DC with amplifier. So we also deploy amplifier to amplify the signal. So with this solution, with this technique of increasing the exchange supply voltage from 48 to 72 bar 96, we can, with amplifier, we can serve the customers up to 95%. Beyond 8 kilometers, suppose if the customer is located beyond 8 kilometers, loading coils are used for better frequency versus attenuation characteristics. So if the distance is more than 8 kilometers, this is say it represents the maximum distance of 8 kilometers. Of course, this represents 5 kilometers. So let us assume somewhere is at 10 kilometers, that is beyond 8 kilometers. So what we do, we introduce loading coils at a suitable distance. This LC represents the inductance, or in the industry it is called loading coil. So with this you will be able to cover even up to 98% of the subscribers. Invariably you have read up. But the gauge of the wire is common in all the three scenarios. So if you are using 26 AWG for 5 km, for 8 km also we are using same gauge, and for 10 km also you are using the same 26 AWG wire only. This is about uni-gauge concept. Then we have another issue of providing communication in rural areas where the subscriber density is very less and the users are located here and there. They are not concentrated in a small geographical area. So here we will try to understand what are all the solutions for rural network, subscriber loop systems in rural network and solutions. In rural areas, subscribers are generally dispersed. They are not concentrated here and there. It is both unnecessary and expensive to provide a dedicated pair for every subscriber. Therefore, three techniques are used to gain on the pairs. So, in a rural scenario where the subscriber density is less, so you cannot afford to provide a separate cable pair for each and every customer. That is normal technologies. Every customer should have his own pair of wires. So, but in case of rural, where you have very less number of connections and the connections are also at different distances, so we have to go for some techniques to gain on the pairs. By using single pair, perhaps we may be able to provide two or three customers. And what are the different techniques we have and the merits and demerits of each and every technique, we will try to understand in nutshell. So one solution is known as party lines. We will try to understand what is the meaning of party lines. The other solution is exploiting concentrators. The third solution is the carrier systems. How we will address? First, let us discuss about party lines. Two or more subscribers are connected to one line, which is termed as party line. This is a telephone exchange. There are three users in this diagram, as I have depicted. All the three are sharing the same cable pair. There is no separate cable pair for user 1 you and user 2 and user 3. So all are share, all are connected on the same cable pair. So what is the pros and cons of this? So this line is known as party line. The single line which is serving more than two users is known as party line. This scheme is not used commonly as it has a number of drawbacks. So it got some drawbacks. Therefore, though the concept is available technically, but we may not resort to this solution for addressing the rural network issues. So what are these drawbacks? Here, some three are enumerated. Only one subscriber at a time can use the line because all three are connected on the same cable pair. Only out of these three, only one can speak at a given time. So unless otherwise he disconnects other two people, they cannot make call because the loop is common. That is one thing. The second issue, selective ringing is difficult and privacy is not maintained. Suppose somebody is calling one of these three subscribers. So all three are connected to the same line. So when the ring comes from the telephone exchange, so if the ringtone is same for all the three numbers, so everybody gets ring and everybody lifts. So what you have to do for one, you have to provide one type of ringing tone. Two, you have to provide another type of ringing tone. And three, you have to provide another type of ringing tone. So it is also not an easy task and it is a cumbersome process. This is another drawback. And moreover, privacy is another issue. Suppose, let us assume one has lifted and speaking at the same time, if two or three or both two and three, if they lift their telephone, they can overhear the conversation of the one with his calling party. So privacy is an issue here. Dialing between two subscribers on the same line is not possible. Let us assume two wants to speak with three because both are sharing the same line. So two cannot dial number three because same loop. So this is another problem. So the conversation between the party line subscribers is not possible. So other with other numbers they can talk. But of course, these issues are there, like privacy and selective ringing and all those things are there. So this is one type of solution, but it got its own disadvantages. Next solution, rural network solutions. Under this, we adopt a technique known as concentrator technique. What is that? We will try to understand. In concentrator technique, a concentrator expander CE, this is the CE at the exchange end, this is the CE at the remote place. Okay, a concentrator expander is used near the cluster of users and the other CE at the exchange end. Okay, so here this is the main exchange end, where the subscriber density is more. This is the remote place where a few customers are there. Let us assume only some 20 users are there within this area. Okay? Only a few junctions lines are run between the CEs which have switching capability. Typically, a ratio of 1:10 in between the junction lines and the subscriber lines is used. The CE at the exchange end remotely powers and controls the CE at the subscriber end. This is the area where you are having a few subscribers, say for example, some 20 subscribers are there. So this is the main exchange area. Here maybe the subscribers served by the main exchange may be in the order of thousands. So to communicate these 20 subscribers in our example, to speak to anyone, they have to pass through the exchange. So they are both, these areas are interconnected by concentrator expander equipment. So here the advantage is, we assume generally it is happens that all the 20 subscribers may not use their telephone. So therefore, what we do between the CE at the subscriber end and the CE at the exchange end, we provide limited number of junctions. As shown here, let us assume there are two junctions. These two wires form one junction, these two wires form other junction. So in the 1:10 ratio, assuming here some 20 users are there, so if you provide two junction lines, it is sufficient. That means at any given time, two people from this area can talk to the main exchange people or to any other exchange people. So the CE at the exchange end, for this CE, it requires the power, battery supply voltage is required, DC voltage is required, and some controlling should be there for this CE equipment. So this is taken care of by the parent CE at the exchange. This CE will take care of providing the supply, power, and the controlling functionalities. The exchange CE will take care of this aspect. So, another solution, rural network solutions. Carrier system. So, we can use what is known as carrier systems. Carrier systems employ multiplexing techniques and enable all the users to access the exchange over a single line or media. So as we have seen in the analog communication or a digital communication, a media, a single media between the two exchanges or the exchange and the remote area can have more number of channels, so that all the users, if required, can be connected to the main exchange for their communication. Here we can have different technologies. We will look into the what are all the different carrier system technologies. So of course some are outdated, let us look into that. Analog frequency division multiplexing or time division multiplexing systems are used. So for this rural communication of remote place with the main exchange, you can go for frequency division multiplexing. For on analog communication or the state of the art TDM, time division multiplexing, can be used. For analog frequency division multiplexing systems, coaxial cable systems and micro systems can be used. They are basically analog in nature. Nowadays, no analog system is working in the network. They have become obsolete. Even some 30 years back, we have closed the analog network. At present, they are obsolete and no more in the telecom network. So we have to go for a digital multiplexing, that is TDM only. For digital TDM systems, we can use PCM or microwave or the state of the art fiber optic systems of different capacities. Some examples I have given. So you can have a 30 channel PCM system, 120 channel, microwave or 480 channel microwave or optical fiber systems and so on. Still higher capacities are also available. So you can connect both the main and the rural exchange with the help of time division multiplexed, state of the art PCM or microwave or fiber optic networks. So we can address the issue of rural network problems mainly by going for concentrator and carrier systems. The party line is not suitable. It got so many disadvantages. So the best solutions, though theoretically three types of solutions we have studied, these two solutions are more practicable. Then we will discuss about the subscriber loop systems with reference to exchange functions. So the exchange has to perform certain functions on the subscriber loop. What are these functions? And we will study in nutshell about different functionalities. The exchange has to perform a set of functions for proper signaling and voice communication on subscriber lines. So the telephone exchange has to perform certain functions on the subscriber loop for proper working of the signaling and for satisfactory voice communication. These functions are performed by an interface called at the exchange end and known as subscriber loop interface card, SLIC card. So these exchange functions are performed by one interface card, which is technically known as subscriber loop interface card. The abbreviation for this is SLIC. The acronym is SLIC. Then some functions are required in analog networks, some in digital networks, and others in both. So all the functions are not common for analog networks and digital networks. Some functions are exclusive use of analog. Some functions are exclusive use of digital networks. Some are required either it is a digital network or analog network. Of course, I can add that analog networks nowadays, they are not working. That is different, but as far as the requirement of the subscriber loop systems and the functions of the exchange on subscriber loop system is concerned, so we do require different type of functions for analog networks and different for digital. Some are common for both analog and digital. The complete set of functions are known by the acronym, by the abbreviation VORSCHT. So this is the acronym which indicates as many as seven functions. Each letter represents one function on subscriber loop from the exchange side with the help of SLIC. VORSCHT is an acronym for the set of functions performed by a subscriber line interface circuit in the line card of a telecom system. So what are these functions performed by the SLIC? One is B, stands for battery feed. We will study a little bit about each and every function. Then V stands for over voltage protection. Then R stands for ringing. And 4 stands for, S stands for signaling. C stands for coding. H stands for hybrid function. T stands for testing function. So we will study one after the other in nutshell. Functions of battery feed, B stands for battery or battery feed, and R ringing or self-accumulatory. So you require DC supply, battery supply for your telephone instrument to function. And similarly, ringing current is required. So you should get a ring when someone is calling you. So they are as simple as it is. Then we will come to about the O. O stands for here over voltage production, which deals with production of equipment and personnel from lightning strikes and power lines. Whenever there is lightning strike or the power line surges and they come in contact with our telephone lines, so you have to protect not only the equipment and the persons working in the telephone exchanges. So for that, so over voltage protection equipment is required, so which is available SLIC, subscriber line interface circuits. Then about signaling, only one example here it is given. Signaling means any, it may be like off hook. When you lift the telephone, so it is a supervisory function, so the exchange should know a loop is extended from a specific subscriber and dial tone is to be given to him, then he can dial the number whatever he intends to talk or contact. Similarly, the pulses should go, exact pulses, whatever the number you are dialing, the same number should get a ring from the exchange. So that means the numbers whatever you are dialing should be properly recognized by the switch. Then about coding, so it is exclusive to digital switching interface. This is mainly for a digital switch, the present day digital switch. In digital switching, analog to digital and digital to analog conversions and some form of coding and decoding takes place. As far as digital switching is concerned, whatever you speak is in analog, but the switch works on a digital technology, because nowadays we are working on digital techniques, digital exchanges. So whatever the voice that is coming in the analog form from the user is to be converted into digital formats, so that the exchange can understand the requirement of the subscriber and accordingly it can connect to the called party. Similarly, when the exchange is sending the signal or the voice to the subscriber, so the exchange is on working on digital, but your loop carries only analog signals. Before it is, the information is sent on the subscriber loop, it is to be converted into analog form. So in digital exchange, you do require analog to digital and digital to analog, and apart from that, some coding or decoding also is required. So this is vital for digital switching. Then we will try to understand a little bit about balanced circuits. Simultaneously, let us look into the drawing also. Subscribers are connected to the exchange via two wires. So we know two wires are required. So this is the two wires between the exchange and the subscriber. Okay. These circuits are balanced connections as shown in the figure. So they are all these connections, these two wire connections are balanced. Here you see the center tap is earthed. Balanced connections overcome many drawbacks of unbalanced circuits. So balanced connections are very much helpful for addressing certain problems. The transmission lines have equal impedance with reference to the ground and hence do not act an antenna to pick up the signals. Since the impedance of the both the wires with reference to the earth, with reference to the earth is equal. So, and it cannot act, the wire cannot act as an antenna and pick up unnecessary signals, unwanted signals. So that is the importance of the balanced circuits. Since the ground is not part of the signal path, hum is eliminated. So the suppose if the telephone is connected by a single wire and earth is used as ground is used as the return path, so it may pick up some hum or some noise, some type of noise is known as hum. So since we are using two wires and if they are balanced wires, so hum is eliminated between the telephone exchange and the telephone user. Now we will look into the hybrid functionality of SLIC. So simultaneously, let us look into the this drawing also. Digital exchanges require receive and transmit signals on separate two-wire circuits. This calls for two-wire to four-wire conversion. So all the digital exchanges, they work on four-wire basis. Four-wire basis means two wires are required for input, two wires are required for output. But your telephone is connected by means of two-wire circuits. So you have to convert the speech or the signal from two-wire communication between the user and the exchange to four-wire path in the switch, so that one represent the trans path, other represent the receive path. The circuit that performs two-wire to four-wire conversion is called hybrid. A transformer-based hybrid circuit is shown in the figure. So the equipments, the network element which converts this two-wire signal into four-wire signal of input and output is known as hybrid. So here we are using the transformer with different tappings to convert this two-wire communication to four-wire communication. This is the hybrid transformer based. Of course, nowadays we are not using this type of transformer based hybrid. Now electronic circuits have come up which can convert the two-wire signal into four-wire signal. Now the present day hybrid is nothing but a electronic circuits. The main function of a hybrid is to ensure that there is no coupling of signal from the input to the output in the four-wire circuit. So the main function is to isolate the input and output. So this is the input. So from the switch, let us assume you are getting the signal. So that is to be, that will be sent on the two-wire line to the user. Similarly, whatever the user speaks will come here and it goes in the output and goes to the further switching. So this is the output path. So the hybrid helps in coupling between the input and output. The input path and output paths are separated in the network. So that is the function of the hybrid. The hybrid you can simply remember as a component which converts the two-wire path into four-wire path. Two wires for input, two wires for output. Then the other function is test function. So you have to test the lines or the exchange. For that, this function is to be incorporated in the SLIC card. The test function enables forward test of the loop. Forward test of the loop means exchange to subscriber. So from exchange, you want to test the subscriber, this is known as forward test. And inward test of the switch, that is from subscriber you want to test up to the exchange. So this is inward test. So these two are the important test functions. So inward and outward, or forward or inward test functions are performed by the testing component of the SLIC circuits. IC manufacturers have successfully developed a single chip called subscriber loop interface circuit that performs all the interface functions required for an electronic exchange. So, with the developments and advent of VLSI technology, IC technology before that, so they are able to incorporate all the functionalities into one single circuits known as SLIC. With a single chip, you are able to achieve all the seven functionalities, whatever we have discussed so far. With this, the current trend is to use one SLIC per subscriber. Unlike the earlier, that is older systems, where one analog to digital converter and digital to analog converter was being shared by a number of lines. So at present, each subscriber will have his own SLIC interface. But in earlier, there used to be a separate analog to digital, digital to analog converter, one equipment, which used to serve a few customers, say for example, some 8 customers. So now it is not like that with the electronics, development in electronics, in each every subscriber card, so the SLIC is incorporated. The development in VLSI technology has led to the single chip telephones that can be powered completely from the telephone loop, that is from exchange. And the present day telephone instrument with microprocessor enables features like automatic redialing and phone book, etc. Some more information they have given. So with the development of very large scale integration technology in electronics, so single chip telephones are available which can be powered from the telephone exchange through subscriber loop. And some more advanced present day telephone instruments, they are coming with a small microprocess. This facilitates some additional benefits, additional facilities that normally nowadays we are more familiarized with mobile instrument, like automatic redialing. You have dialed one number, so it is number is engaged. You want to once again redial it, so you can redial it, automatic redialing. Simply, you can maintain a phone book also. The landline telephone instrument with microprocessors, they got the facility of phone book also. Like this, some more facilities are available with the use of microprocessor in the telephone instrument. So this is all about the part 2 of subscriber loop systems. With this, we conclude our discussion on subscriber loop systems. So if you like my video, please subscribe to my channel and also share among your groups and friends, and also give me a like as an encouragement. Thank you.